If you read my recent blog, you'll know that SAP AppGyver last week added support for BTP destinations, meaning it's simple to add SAP backend data to your AppGyver app. In the BTP version of AppGyver, you can now select whether you want your app available only to authenticated users of your BTP subaccount. Once you do that, you'll have access to all of the destinations in that subaccount. You select a destination, which should point to a specific OData service, and you get a discovery UI, which lets you see all of the entities and to browse the data. When you're ready, you select the entities you want available in your app. From there, creating the app is the same as always. You create a data variable and bind the data to your UI controls. You can instead use the data adapter controls, which were also recently announced, which make it easier to bind data without the use of data variables. What I found cool is in 10 minutes, I could get my data from my S4HANA system into my AppGyver app and even implement filtering, sorting, and paging. Just note that SAP AppGyver is only available in BTP in the Europe Frankfurt EU10 region. Teams are working feverishly to add regions and to add a free tier plan, hopefully by later this year.
The SAP Business Technology Platform is the essential runtime and management infrastructure for today's enterprise computing. And the BTP CLI is the essential command line interface tool for interacting with and managing resources on SAP BTP. I'm a big fan of the BTP CLI, and it gives me great pleasure to let you know that there's a customer engagement initiative all around the BTP CLI, where you can get involved to provide feedback, discuss your current and future requirements, and also validate upcoming concepts and designs. The initiative starts in earnest in September, but registration ends soon. So head on over to the initiative's homepage right now and get involved.
The SAP Cloud Application Programming Model version 6.0 was published this week. Have a look at the SAP Cloud Application Programming Model release schedule in the help documentation, and you'll notice that this is the major yearly release. There's details there about all that that entails, but it means that the former 5.0 version is now in maintenance mode with only critical bug fixes that will be supplied. It also means that version 4.0 goes to end-of-life status, and in keeping with alignment with the underlying Node.js runtimes, it means that support is now dropped for Node.js version 12. But it isn't just about the availability of versioning. There's also lots of great new functionality that's available. I could only pick out a few of the highlights. Be sure to refer to the release notes that are available in the packages themselves and on the help documentation site for full details. But a couple that I picked out were the ability now, in addition to importing service definitions with EDMX, we can now import open API definitions as well. The formerly experimental GraphQL support moves into an early general availability status and is now delivered as a separate package that you can bring into your project under the @SAP/CDS GraphQL. And all the instructions of how to use this new package are available in the README of the package in NPN. And finally, the Cloud Application Programming Model now has new functionality to help you deploy your applications to Kima and Kubernetes. There's a new command, CDS add helm, which will add helm charts to your project, as well as a new deployment guide coming soon to the online help. So as always, check out the full release notes for all the other great new functionality that we didn't have time to tell you about. And if you're looking for more Cloud Application Programming Model news, there's also great news about the recap event. The recap of recap is now available, meaning the online replays of all the great sessions that took place at the beginning of June event. are available for you to view. So if you missed any of Recap eventually, go ahead and check out those recordings.
Welcome to July, the start of the SAP Community Spotlight Month for the SAP BTP Kima Runtime. This month is all about the Kima Runtime and cloud-native technologies like Kubernetes and containerization. For that purpose, we've created a brand new code challenge for you, where you have challenges coming up each week for 4 weeks, where you learn all the fundamentals of cloud-native development from Kubernetes to deploying your first service to the SAP Kima Runtime. In order to join and participate the code challenge and the SAP Community Spotlight Month, you can check out the blog post in the description below and join us in the group section of the SAP community.
If you are working with SAP HANA, then you might remember from the previous SAP developer news that the new 3.5 version of GDAL now includes a vector OGR HANA driver. GDAL is an open source translator library for geospatial data formats, and it comes with a variety of useful command line utilities for data translation and data processing. This week, I published two blog posts with more details and some practical tips. In the first one, I shared some examples of using SAP HANA with GDAL software, like importing geospatial data from a file in the Google Earth KML format. In the second one, I explained the steps to build GDAL binaries, including OGR SAP HANA driver, and I shared some practical notes from my experience of building them. Hopefully you find these posts helpful, and I'm looking forward to you sharing your examples using the software and your comments on the build process.